Philippians chapter 3, and we start reading from verse number 10. Here the Bible says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on, that I may lay hold of that which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind. And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even these to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us be of the same mind. May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his word in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, from this passage of scripture, quick things I want us to see before we go too deeply is, number one, I want you to see the apostle, Paul the apostle's desire. The desire of Paul the apostle, we see his desire to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. He said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. That is the desire of Paul the apostle. He wanted Christ to be revealed through him. He wanted the image of Christ to be formed in him. He wanted the people, when they see him, that they should see Jesus Christ manifest fully in his body. That's the first thing, the apostle's desire. The second thing I want you to see is the apostle's pursuit. I mean, his diligent pursuit for the reason why Christ called him. His desire to fulfill the very purpose of God for his life. Look at that same verse number 12. The Bible says that, not that I have already attained or I'm already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold. In other words, that I may attain that for which Christ himself laid hold on me. In other words, there was a reason why Jesus Christ invited me into the kingdom. There was a reason why he accosted me on my way to Damascus to cause havoc on his church. There was a reason why he brought me out of my former life into this present life. Now my desire, my pursuit, my ambition, my goal is to make sure I fulfill that purpose. There's a reason why I am a child of God. My pursuit is to make sure I fulfill the very reason why Christ himself called me in. Number three thing I want you to see is the apostle's strategy. That is, his strategy for forgetting those things which are behind him so that he can get what Christ has called him for. There's a strategy. He said, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. In other words, I know God called me for something. I know there's something that God wants to do through me. But there is a way you have to go by it in order to be able to get the result you are looking for. Not everything you do will give you the result that you are looking for. Not every path you take will take you to the place where you are going. Paul the apostle is saying there is a strategy. There is a way in which I want to live my life so that I can fulfill the very purpose for which God has called me. Number four, we see the apostle's resolve. The apostle's resolve. In other words, that is his determination to keep on pressing on to the goal, for the upward goal that Christ has called him. Look at that verse number 13 again. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forward to those things which are ahead. In other words, there are so many things that are calling my attention. So many things that want me that wants my time, that wants my resources, that want my energy. But I say no. I say I am resolved. Say one thing I do is I forget all the things that are in the past. That I make sure that I reach for those things that are in front of me so that I can fulfill the very purpose for which God has called me. I am resolved to pursuing that particular goal. And then finally, we see the apostles' counsel. The apostles' counsel. That is his advice to the church as to the attitude that they should take as a march towards the very reason why God has called them. Say that now, look at number 15, verse 15. Say, therefore, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind. In other words, those of us who have matured in the faith, Those of us who have grown in the faith, those of us who have walked with the Lord to a certain extent, he said you need to have this same mind of pursuing the thing that God has called you for. You should pursue those things that only take you to where God wants to take you. You should do it in such a way that you are determined. You should have it as a single goal. You should make sure that you are not distracted. You should make sure that you are disciplined in your pursuit. You say, all of us who are mature, we should have this mind. And if you think you don't need to do it, God himself will talk to you. But make sure you have that mindset. So that was his counsel to the church. In other words, Paul the apostle was telling the church in a simple word. He said, I know who I was before I became born again. I know who I was before Christ called me into the kingdom. I know how Christ rescued me from being a destroyer of the church. And now that I am saved, my desire is to know him. That's why he said that I may know him. My desire is to know him. My goal and my pursuit in life is to become like him, is to become what he wants me to be. And I will not allow my past to stand in the way. That is why I will let go of the past and I will embrace the future that God is calling me onto. This is basically what Paul is telling the church. And the question as always is, why was Paul telling the church about his own personal story? Why was Paul the apostle telling him about his desire for pursuing the calling of God upon his life? Why? If you go back to Philippians chapter 3, reading from verse number 2, you begin to see an idea of why Paul was telling the people why he was telling them. Look at Philippians chapter 3, we start reading from verse number 2. He said, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the mutilation. For we are the circumcision who worship God in the spirit, rejoice in Christ and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else think he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Circumcised on the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Jew, a Hebrew of Hebrew, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning righteousness, which is of the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. In other words, the question again is, why was Paul advising the church that they should pursue the righteousness of God? They should pursue the very purpose for which God has called them. Why was he telling them to pursue the calling of God upon their life? Let me suggest to you that Paul was telling the church about his own personal story and telling them to pursue their calling in Christ because he knows the danger of evil influence. He knows the danger of evil influence. Look at that, Philippians chapter 3 verse 2. The Bible says, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the mutilation. And if you recall in Galatians chapter 3, it was this same group of people, the people that referred to as the mutilation. These were the Judaizers who were trying to convince people that when you are born again, you need to be physically circumcised. And these same people came into the Galatian church and they messed them up. And Paul the apostle in Galatians chapter 3 verse 1 told us the question. He said, oh Galatians, who has bewitched you that you will not obey the truth? That was the same people he was telling them about. That's what he's saying. I'm telling you all this because there are evil influence, even within the church. People who will drag you out of what God has called you to do. People who will make sure you are distracted. People who will make sure that you are not focused on the purpose of God for your life. That is why I am telling you to make sure that you pursue the calling of God upon your life. Number two, why was Paul telling them? Paul was telling them because he knows the deception of personal attainment. The deception of personal attainment. Look at that, Philippians chapter 3, in verse number 4. He said, if anyone else think they have a confidence in the flesh, I more so. If you think you are rich, I was rich. If you think you are educated, I studied. If you think you have influence, I have all the influence because I have a personal letter from the Pharisee, from the chief priest, to be able to prosecute. So he's talking about his personal attainment. He said, I was circumcised on the eighth day. If you want to call yourself a Hebrew, I am a Hebrew. If you want to say that you are more religious, I am very religious. You know how to obey the law. I am perfect in the law. I'm blameless. So if you look at reading from verse number 4, he says, if anyone else think he has confidence in the flesh, I am also. Verse number 5, circumcised on the eighth day, a Hebrew of Hebrew, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning righteousness of the law, blameless. In other words, I am good. And so if you rely on your own ability, if you rely on your own prosperity, you rely on your own connection, You rely on your own education. He said you will not be able to follow the will of God. You won't. Because that is what he had, and he was already missing the way. That was what he had, and he was headed in the wrong direction. So he was telling them, number one, because of the fact that there are evil influence within the church. Number two, because there is the deception of personal attainment. When you have attained something, you feel deceived, you feel impossible, you feel invisible, sorry. And that is why you check it out. It is very difficult to minister to people who are highly educated. Because they would dissect it with their brain. How can this be? How can this be? If the people who are rich, it's very difficult to preach to them. It doesn't mean that they cannot be born again. It just means that it's more difficult for them. And that's what Paul the Apostle is saying. To pursue the high calling of Christ. The reason why Christ has brought you in to pursue it, he said you have to be able to realize that there is evil in the world. There are evil influence around you. You have to realize that there's deception in personal attainment. But finally, number three, Paul the Apostle was telling them the story. He's saying that I'm telling you the story because I know the destruction that comes when you keep holding on to your past, when you refuse to let your past go. Say, but what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss. In other words, in those days, I mean, anywhere I show up, everybody will be afraid. When Paul the Apostle shows up to the church will take cover. When they were stoning Stephen, he was standing there with his cloak, giving command. He went to the high priest, collected letters so that he can go all over the provinces to be able to do havoc. But all those things gave him respect. It gave him access. It gave him all sorts of opportunities. But when he met Christ, he had to leave all those things to be able to go to where God wants to take him. Paul understood that as long as he held on to his high priest, his high Pharisee office, as long as he refused to let go of the privilege and the power associated with that office, he will never be able to move in the direction that God wanted him to go. And the same thing happens to us. If we refuse to let go of our past, we refuse to let go of all the blessings and the benefits and the goodness that our past brings into our life, the access that it brings into our life, we may not be able to pursue what God wants for us. So he had to let it go. He had to be able, for him to be able to enter the future that God had in store for him, he had to let him go. Jesus himself said in Matthew chapter 6, if you read from verse number 24, he said, no one can serve two master. You cannot be in the world and be in the kingdom at the same time. It is not possible. You cannot love God and love the devil at the same time. You cannot want to enjoy the blessings of the world and at the same time the privileges of the kingdom. It is not going to happen. The Bible says no one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You have to let one of them go. And that is what Paul the Apostle was saying. So we cannot make progress into the future while looking into the rearview mirror. You can't do it. You can't say that, yeah, I'm pursuing, I'm going in the direction that God wants me to go. But at the same time, I keep looking at the good things that have happened to me in the past, the blessings that I've enjoyed in the past, the things that I've had in the past. He said, you cannot do that. If you do that, you are going to have problems. The children of Israel had that same problem. They were traveling the direction that God wanted them to go into the promised land. But every opportunity they had, they would talk about Egypt. Oh, in Egypt, we used to eat garlic. Oh, we used to eat this one. Oh, we used to eat that one. They kept reminding themselves of what used to be. As such, they were not able to enter the place that God had prepared for them. The question is, why will people not let go of the past? Why? Why will people not let go of the past? Why do we hold on to the past so tenaciously that we refuse to let it go? So you see, my brothers and sisters, letting go is necessary. You know, letting go is necessary because holding on to the past makes distraction very, very easy. As long as we refuse to let go, okay? Why you must let go now? Why you must let go of your past so that you can move forward is because as long as you are holding on to that thing of the past, you will become easily distracted. For those of us who are married, you had a good relationship with a young man or a young woman before you got married. Now you continue to hold on to that particular relationship. You are looking for trouble in that new marriage. For those of us, you know this one happens to a lot of those of us who are immigrants. When we get to this place and things are not going well, we say, oh, back home in this, back home in that. If that place was so good, what are you doing here? I'm not saying that there are not good things about COVID. That's not what I'm saying. But the thing is that we have the idea, we have this tendency to romanticize about the past. And if you do that, there's a strong tendency that we will become distracted. And that is one of the reasons why we must let go. Number two, why must we let go? If we refuse to let go, we stand, there's a possibility that we'll become stagnated. Because you are always looking at the back, you will not be able to move forward. Okay? We will not be able to move forward. And you'll find out that if you continue to look at the successes that we've had in the past, the beauty of the places where we used to occupy, how influential we used to be in the past, the kind of people that used to come and beg us in the past, the places where we used to go in the past, all the people that gave us respect in the past. If you sit on that, you will not be able to move forward. And many of us are in that condition. The life we used to have, the respect we used to have, the people that used to come to us. And then if we sit on that particular idea and we begin to ruminate on those things, you will find out that progress becomes very difficult and stagnation becomes real. Because you will not be able to take advantage of the opportunities that are in front of you. You will see yourself, it may not me talking to me like that. In those days, when I used to be this, then you begin to tell a story. There are some group of people in Nigeria that I used to refer to in those days when I was growing up. We call them have been to. You know? I have been to. Anytime they talk to you, I've been to London. I've been to America. I've been to this one. I've been to that one. So we call them I've been to. And they never do anything. Anytime you talk to them, I've been when I was in Italy, we know you were there. What are you doing now? The point we are trying to make is that when you hold too tightly to the past, when you refuse to let go of those good things that may have happened to you in the past, or even the bad things, because there are some people, because of the hurt that they've experienced, they refuse to move forward. Because they have been disappointed by a guy, they refuse to get married. Or they have been disappointed by a woman, they refuse to get married. You know, the idea is that whatever good or bad that has happened to us in the past, if we refuse to let go, or we hold on to that evil, or hold on to that pain, or hold on to that success inordinately, you will find out that progress in life becomes very difficult. And then finally, most importantly, when we refuse to move ahead from the past, or refuse to let go of the past, the tendency for us, you now find that resentment, anger, and bitterness becomes a reality in our lives. Okay? It becomes a reality because you begin to see. You begin to feel. When you see people moving forward, you begin to get jealous of them. You begin to get angry at them. And this one happened to ladies a lot. And that is why you see ladies beginning to compete with their daughters for youth. You know? They refuse to get old. Because they found out that in our own days, we used to be XYZ. And now the young ones are coming out. They are looking more beautiful than you. So what happened? Let's tighten this one there. Let's tighten this one up. Let's lift this one up. At the end of the day, if you see them on TV and they want to smile, God help us. It's very difficult. Their face is so tight, they can't even smile. But that's a story for another day. The point we are making is that if you refuse to let go, if we hold on to the past, so tightly, you will find out that bitterness, anger, and resentment becomes a reality in our lives. And because of the danger of holding too tightly to the past, that was why Paul was telling the church, don't get yourself sucked up in this bad attitude of holding on to things too tightly. And that is one of the biggest challenges in this culture. They don't know how to forget anything. They don't know how to forget anything. It's just a question of the person that you have, you know, if you anger somebody and that person is sufficiently motivated and have enough resources, he will make sure you never forget it. Because at every opportunity, when they put your name into that system, the thing will show up. What you have done 50 years ago. Okay? And then you know how it happened in our culture. Where we got to the point of me too. He touched me when I was this. He tickled me when I was 2 years old. All those things. And they will destroy people's lives. The issue here is Paul is saying, don't get sucked into it. Because it might appear to give you a benefit, but at the end of the day, it is going to be destructive in our life. Don't be too concerned about your past to the point that you miss your present and then forfeit your future. The children of Israel, like I said earlier, had this very bad habit. They love to ruminate on the past. They love to look at the things that is not present for them. Anytime they have this discomfort, they will tell you about how good it was when they were slaves in Egypt. And as a result, they ended up dying in the wilderness, not getting to the place where God wanted to tell them. This tells us that when we are stuck in the past, we lose sight of the present and we forfeit our future when we do that. Okay? And that is why the Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 43. In Isaiah 43, reading from verse number 18, the Bible says, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Why? Because if you keep doing that, you will miss a chance of what God is about to do. But what did the Lord Bible tell us? In verse number 19, the Bible says, behold, I will do a new thing. In other words, the old things have passed. Now I am going to do a new thing. Okay? Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way I will make a road in the wilderness, a river in the desert. That means I will make the impossible possible. If you are willing to let go of that disappointment of the past. If you are willing to let go of those things that you think were the best thing that ever happened to you. If you are willing to let go of yesterday and focus on today so that you can see what God has for you tomorrow, then you will begin to see rivers in the deserts. Okay? Don't be get stuck in the attitude of not letting things go. Don't be deceived into holding on to that, because when you dwell on the past, you lose sight, like I said, you lose sight of, you know, of what the future has to say, of what tomorrow has to give. Okay? Now, we've been talking about this idea of letting go, letting go, letting go. The question is, what does it mean to let go? What does it mean to be able to set, you know, forget about the past? To hold on, you know, to let go, or to, you know, or to hold on to the past, you know, and not letting go simply means that we are holding on to feelings. We are holding on to emotions. We are holding on to thoughts that should no longer be influencing our lives. That's what it simply means. You're holding on to things that you should have let go, that you'd have allowed to stop holding on to. Somebody makes you angry, made you angry maybe when you were 10. Now that you are almost 70, you are still holding on to that thing. Anytime you see the picture of that person, it angers you because you feel that that person wronged you. You are holding on to an emotion. You are holding on to a feeling. You are holding on to a thought that you should not allow to continue to dominate or to influence your life. That's what you mean by letting things go, when you refuse to let things go. To hold on to the past and not let things go simply means that we are replaying certain images in our mind. You are replaying the images. You are reliving the past over and over and over and over again. Anything that didn't happen, it takes you back to a place. And you start reliving. It's like you are pressing a tape. I don't remember in those days you were. Now you don't. Many of us, you know. Okay, everybody here should know what I'm about to talk. You know how you have this cassette tape? You know, that cassette tape. Aha, you put in the disc, you play the thing you like, you play it again. You play, you know, you push the rewind. That's what many of us are doing. We keep rewinding our life and reliving that issue over and over and over again. It's like our life is on an unending loop. You just keep going around the same circle over and over and over again. And the Lord is saying that when you do that, you cannot move forward. You can't. It's like you're running around in a circle. You can never break free from it. And the question is, why do people do such things? Why do we make sure, why do we relive the past in our head? Why do we put our lives in a loop? Why do we make sure, why do we have difficulty letting things of the past go? Why? Why do we hold on to the past so tenaciously? Quickly, I'll just give you a couple of reasons. The first reason is because of what we call nostalgia. Okay? This sentimental yearning for the past. When you think, oh, yesterday was so beautiful. Oh, it was so beautiful in those days when we were still in high school. When we were wearing shorts, we were the best thing that ever happened. You know, you begin to romanticize about the past. Especially when you are telling your kids. You never see a parent that said, I failed when I was in school. They were always the best, they are always the best student in the class. Every parent is the best student in the class. If you talk about him, them at the party, oh, they were the life of the party. Even the ones who don't go party, they could tell you they were the best. They always have this idea about the past has been very, very good. When you are, people hold on to the past because of this nostalgic, feeling. They want to relive the past, which is, I mean, it's allowed. Every now and then you're supposed to, you are allowed to, to fantasize about how good yesterday was. Number two reason why people hold on to the past is because of the unknown, the fear of the unknown future. They are so comfortable with the environment right now. They know where everything is. They know how everything works. They know the people in their lives. So they not tell them to now move and go to another place. What will happen there? Who will I meet there? Will the people like me? Will the area be okay? Will I have this issue? Will I have this? Because of that fear of the unknown, they don't want to let go. And it happens to a lot of us. And even now that we are planning this particular move, there is still a lot of anxiety in the heart of some of us who are saying, huh, is this guy sure what he's doing? Are you going to be able to maintain this thing? Are you going to be? There are so many questions. If you are afraid or there's a fear of the unknown, there's a tendency for us to always want to hold on to the past. Number three, why do people hold on to the past? People hold on to the past because of the assurance and the relevance that they had at that time. I mean, in the days when boys were boys, everybody came to me. They asked for my advice. You read the book of Job. The Bible tells us that when Job, before Job suffered anything, he said, when I was coming, he said, even my talking like this, nobody looks at my face. He said, kings took advice from me. Young men were always bowed down for me at the gate. They waited for me to give my advice. My advice was that the sound of angels speaking. That was me before I was sick. Now I'm sick. You are talking rubbish to me. So there is a tendency for us to hold on to the past when there is this past respect, past privileges that we've enjoyed, places of honor that we have sat in, the people that were, nobody wants that to come to an end. And so we keep reliving those things. And that is one of the reasons why people don't like to let go of the past. Number four, some people hold on to the past because they just don't want to accept the reality on the ground. Somebody died. You know, a son or somebody loses a son or a daughter. He said, no, he traveled. He's not at home. He refuses to accept. He wants to hold on to the picture of old, the picture that he used to have. That particular picture, a place of joy, a place where they have comfort. That is the picture that they want to maintain. So they deny the reality on the ground. They deny the reality that they know. It's just like somebody who used to live very, very rich. All of a sudden, you lost his job, lost his business, but he refuses to cut down on his expenses. Still keep living like that because people are coming. They believe that he was a rich man and he wants to continue to play the part. And so people denying realities make them to hold on to the past. But most importantly, a lot of people hold on to the past because they simply don't want to forgive. They simply don't want to forgive. They have this idea that if they forgive somebody who wrongs them, that person has gone free. You're just going to let him go like that. Yeah, he's not going to suffer for what he has done. They have that idea. And because they have refused to forgive, they continue to hold on to the past. Inability to forgive. That was the issue. So please understand, when you do that, when I do that, if we know anybody who do that, you will realize that that individual who is doing something like that will inevitably, imprison themselves when you refuse to let go. Because there is no way you can hold somebody down and you will go up. If you do something like this, you're pressing that thing down, you can't go anywhere. Because as long as your hand is there, you are not going anywhere. And that is what happens. When we pay too much attention to the things of the past and we refuse to let go, we inadvertently imprison our own selves. Okay? Because you lock yourself up. You can't go. Until you let that thing go, you will not be able to go anywhere. Number two, the danger of not letting go is the danger of bitterness and resentment. You will see the people who live in the past. If they see a young boy now prospering, a young boy's career is growing, maybe they tried to sing and they were not able to be successful. And this young man is now singing and is now prospering. Say, what kind of song is he singing? All this year, song that they are singing now. The song that have no meaning. Oh boy, why don't you go and sing your own song who have no meaning so that you two can become followers? But the point is that because they were not successful in their own time and they are holding on to that particular idea, you find that bitterness and resentment grows in the heart of such an individual. And the Bible says, looking carefully, lest everyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness spring up, cause trouble, that many become defiled. Because of the fact that they were disappointed in the past in a particular area, what happened? Anybody who's trying to go in that direction, they don't like it. A young person who's just trying to falling in love, don't worry. Those are men. All the men are useless. Who told you so? He's the one that you picked that was useless. That's a story for another day. That's a story for another day. The point you are making is that when we keep holding on to the past, there is a strong tendency that bitterness and anger. I'm not saying those things are not painful. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that you don't have a right to be able to look into the past. That's not what I'm saying. I'm only saying that when you sit there, when you refuse to move forward, when you base your life based on everything that happened on the past, then you will begin to see bitterness grow in our life. Number three, then you begin to see stagnation because you won't be able to move forward. You will not. Opportunities will come, but you will not be able to see because you are busy looking at the back. And then number four, finally, you will begin to waste away. Because when you are not taking advantage of opportunity, when you are not growing, when you are not moving forward, what happens? You are stagnant. And the more stagnant you are, the more you begin to rot. The more you begin to waste away. The more you begin to do things that are not supposed to be a blessing to you. The Bible says those who are left shall waste away in the iniquities of their enemies. In other words, they will find that progress becomes very difficult. They will begin to do things that will be detrimental to their own progress. Now, seeing the danger of holding on to the past, the question is, how do you let go? How do you let go? How do I let go of those things that hold us back? For some people, it might just be one single event that happened in the past. For some people, it might be a member of the family. For some other people, it might just be the fact that they were disappointed. Some people just might be because of the opportunity that they missed. It might be just one single thing that they are holding on to that is holding them back. The question is, how do we let go? How do we let go of the past that is holding us unconscious, holding us hostage in this present day? The first thing that you do, it is a conscious decision. There's this thing that they used to say. They say, you have to be tired of getting tired. Or you have to be sick of getting sick, or whatever the way they say. But the point you are making is that you must come to a point where you say, no, I can't continue to live like this. You have to come to that conscious decision and say, Lord, it is enough. Look at what Isaiah said in Isaiah 43 verse 18. He said, do not remember the past. Which means it is your responsibility not to remember the past. God will not do it for you. There are some prayer, if you pray, God will not answer. This is the kind of prayer. To let this go, he has given you the power to let it go. If you are saying, Lord, help me to let go. Yes, he might empower you, but he was not going to do it for you. It is a decision that we have to make. So letting go of the past starts with a conscious decision. You make up your mind. I'm tired. I can't do this anymore. I'm not going to allow that man to continue to have dominion over my life. I'm not going to allow that woman to continue to control my life, even when that woman is dead. And my mother did not hug me enough. That was how many years ago? 50 years ago? The woman is dead and you are still alive and you are still complaining and blaming her for all your misfortune? No. So you have to make up your mind and say, this situation will no longer have control over me. Number two, letting go of the past requires to make a determined refusal. It's one thing for you to decide, and then you will refuse. Look at what the Bible said in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. It said, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, let your request be made known unto the Lord God Almighty. You have to say, be anxious for nothing. It's a decision. It's an action. It's a refusal. You say, I refuse to be anxious. I refuse to be worried. I refuse to fret over little things. Yes, situation might not be exactly what I want, but fretting over it doesn't do any different. Jesus Christ said that, which of you having worry is able to add 2 cubits to himself? Okay? Which of you having, which of you can number, with all the worries in this world, can be able to number the hair on your head? For people like, oh, there's no problem because there's nothing there, so there's nothing to count. But for those of you who have more than one, worrying does not add anything to your head. The point you are making is that you have to refuse to do certain things. It's a decision. It's a refusal. Number three, it is unshakable trust. You will say, God has said X, Y, Z. I make a decision to trust him. That's how you let things go. The Bible tells us, he said, you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. If you trust him, he will keep your mind. Then you make up your mind and say, Lord, I want to trust you. That this situation will no longer trouble me. I want to trust you. That this situation will no longer be a problem for me. I want to trust you. There has to be an unshakable trust in the word of the Almighty God. Now, please understand, it doesn't happen overnight. It's little by little. You build the trust little by little. You build the trust little by little. The people that we trust very much in our lives today, how do you build that trust? It's not something that happened overnight. Many of us who are from Africa, when you have a little baby, how do you play with them? You take the baby, you throw them up. You take the baby, you throw them up, right? Initially, when you throw them up, they're scared. You can see it in their eyes that they're afraid. They don't know whether you're going to let them fall or not. But if you catch them, and you do it again, and you do it again, at one point in time, when you throw them up, they start giggling. Why? Because they trust you that they're not going to let them fall. The same thing in your walk with the Almighty God. Initially, it tells you to do something, say,
Okay, God, you sure about this thing?
I say, yes. Then you take the step, you put your hand back. You do it and you put your hand back. As time goes on, as you trust the Almighty God, you begin to take big steps. That's why somebody can tell you, I trust that God will raise the dead. Because they have done small, small things before. They have prayed for headache. They have prayed for this. They have prayed. You who have never prayed for headache, you go to hospital, you say, one lay hands on the dead. They lie. Nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. But that's a story for another day. There has to be, number one, in letting go, a conscious decision. Number two, a determined refusal. Number three, an unshakable trust. Number four, an unbroken focus. An unbroken focus on the thing that you're looking for. Your determination is, I don't want to be controlled by the things of the past anymore. I want to focus on the future. And what is the future? The Bible says, I know the thought that I think towards you, that the thought of good and not of evil, to give you an expected end. There is a goal that God is taking you. There's a place where God is taking you. You focus on where you're going. And when you focus on where you're going, all the things that are around will do what? They will fall away. Jesus Christ himself said in Luke chapter 9, in verse number 62, Jesus said, no one, having put his hands on the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom. In other words, you can't be doing this and be here. No, you can't do that. Your attention must be on the person that you are following. There's this thing that we used to say in the neck of the wood. You say, when you go to the market and you are bargaining stuff, the people that you are trading with, that's the person you focus your attention on. You are trading with the Lord Jesus Christ. You focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. When Peter came, and the Lord was giving Peter, he said, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Peter said, yes, 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 feed my sheep. And then he now saw the John the Beloved going. He said, what about him? Jesus said, what about him? Is John's life your life? Is John's assignment your assignment? He said, if I will that he does not die, what is that to you? In other words, focus on the thing that is important to you. Forget about the things that have happened in the past. There's nothing you can do about it anymore. The only thing you can do with the past is to learn from them, so that you don't repeat the same mistake. So breaking the hold of the past on our life and letting go starts with a decision. Then it requires a refusal. It requires you to trust in the Almighty God. It requires you to keep your focus on the Almighty God, but it also requires daily commitment. Because every now and then your mind will stray. We are all like that. Every now and then our mind will go in different direction, but you have to bring your mind back and say, this is where we're going. This is where God said he's taking us. This is the revelation he has given me. This is the promise that he has made. You keep reminding yourself every day. The Bible tells us in Leviticus chapter 6 verse 12, it says, and the fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. It shall not be put out. The priest shall put wood on it every morning and lay the burnt offering in order on it, and it shall be burned on the fat of the peace offering. Then verse number 13, a fire shall always be burning on the altar. It shall never go out. That requires daily commitment. You wake up in the morning, you make sure the fire is still burning. Every now and then you remind yourself, I don't care what happened in the past. I don't care the pain that I've suffered in the past. I don't care what happened yesterday. Today is a brand new day. The Lord Almighty has made this day and is taking me to a place that he wants to take me. I am going to stay with him. I'm going to believe him. I'm going to trust in him. I will not allow myself to be distracted. That is how you do it. And before you know what's happening, your mind becomes well built up, such that whatever happened in the past stays in the past. And then you are able to focus your attention on what the Almighty God, where the Almighty God is taking you. Just like Paul the Apostle said. So in closing, please understand that God's desire for you, God's desire for me, is for us to be able to be free from our past and go into our future. Micah chapter 7, if you read from verse number 18, the Bible says, who is God like you? Who is a God like you? Pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression of the remnant of the heritage. He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in mercy. He will again have compassion on us and will subdue our iniquities. You shall cast our sins into the depth of the sea. In other words, God is a God that lets go of the past. He's a God that lets go of the past. He's a God that is willing to forgo, forgive, and erase your past. If God is willing to erase, why do you want to keep rewriting it? If God is willing to let go of certain things, why do we want to continue to dredge it up and bring it up? But the first thing that we do, we ourselves, if God is willing to let it go, then what is our responsibility is, we must help, must be willing to throw that thing also away. and the decision to let it go, the decision to throw it away, the decision to be free is in our own power, is in our control. Because God will not do it for us. Just like when it says, if you repent, you will be saved. Unless you repent, you will never be saved. If you refuse to repent, as much as God wants you to be saved, you can never be saved. You have to do it by yourself. The same thing, this baggage that we carry about every day, that's not allowing us to make progress. The baggage we carry into our marriage, the baggage we carry into our business, the one we carry into our relationship, the Lord is saying, I am willing, you will cast all our sins into the depth of the sea. The Lord is willing to take them away. Why are we holding on to it? Why are we holding on to it? And so the question this morning is, are we willing to let go of those things that are holding us back and let God take control? Are we willing to be able to surrender those things at the foot of the cross? That is the question today. Okay? The choice is in our hands. God will not do it. You will have to do that part. Let's bow our heads as we talk to the Almighty God.